And welcome to Brewster's, everybody. Sean.
Yeah.
Celebrate? Not every.
Celebrate.
Are you talking about Donald Trump, or what do we celebrate? Not everybody here is a Donald Trump fan.
No, no. Well, that's a good point. I was thinking more along the lines of celebrating a 62-22 win.
Well, that's worth
Baylor,
the celebration.
But, you know, now that you think about it, this song does kind of work, I guess, both ways.
You got anything else you can load up a little?
Well, I guess it depends on which side of the political spectrum you land
on,
right?
Well, that's true. Let's go right down the middle.
Well, okay. Well, I mean, I do have a song, I guess, so I can play for if you're Hillary Clinton supporters.
Okay.
Is that all right? You want to be fair?
Sure. Let's be fair.
Fair and balanced tonight?
Fair and balanced.
All right. Well, you know what? Okay. So, let's switch this up. All right. Fine. How about this? How about we play... You know, this will work for Baylor, too. I mean, we're celebrating a 62-22 win, so we'll dedicate this song for, you know, be fair, since you wanted the other one for Trump, the Hillary Clinton supporters, and also for Baylor fans. How about this? Here's a good one. An oldie but goodie.
Hello, darkness, my old friend. I've come to talk with you again.
Hello.
I won't sing. Everybody will walk out.
Because a vision softly creeping.
This works for Baylor.
Seeds while
it
I
does.
Was
I guess
sleeping.
Hillary fans, too.
And the vision that
no?
was planted in my
brain. A little too close to the vest?
A little too close to the vest.
Cuts a little too deep.
Yeah,
a little
yeah.
too soon?
A little too soon.
A little too soon? Okay, well, I'll try again. Sorry.
You got one more, huh?
Sorry, guys. Yeah, you know what? How about this one? You know, for those of us who didn't vote for Hillary or Trump, and I fall into that camp.
Or
I'll be honest with
Baylor.
You. I didn't. Well, you know what? I got another song that'll help out for Baylor fans.
Okay.
All right, Baylor fans, I feel your pain. This is dedicated to y'all and anybody else who didn't vote for Trump or Hillary, so just to be fair.
It's the end of the world as we know it.
How's that?
It's the end of the world as we know it. It's the end
okay.
of the world as we know it.
Welcome to the Killer Frogs Hour.
Welcome to Killer Frogs Hour.
We promise that's it for post-election analysis of 2016.
There's that's no it. That's no, as we're political done. As we're going to get.
No. But Baylor, we're coming for you later in the show.
Hey, we are honored to have here tonight with us the head coach of the TCU men's tennis team, David Roditi. Coach, thanks for coming on.
Thank you, Wes. Thanks, Sean. It's great to be back.
Good to have you, Coach.
Glad to have you.
Thank you. Thank
Glad
you.
Glad to Go have
frogs.
You. Go Frogs. You got it. You know, tell me about the Roditi rule. I think you've got the distinction of being the only coach that's got a rule named after him.
Yeah, which really that rule is basically throw every other rule away. It's kind of the premises of that rule. But it didn't last very long. It only lasted one or two seasons. And so the Roditi rule was basically let the fans be the fans and Tennis has a little bit of a perception that you come to a tennis match and sit on your hands and eat strawberries and be all proper. And
it's like and a morgue half the time.
Basically boring.
Golf club.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
So my point was let them behave like any other sport at TCU, like a fan would behave at basketball, and they can
sure.
scream at you when you're throwing free throws, or at baseball when you're trying to hit the ball.
Heckle the players
a little bit. It wasn't so much about heckling, I guess. It was more about cheering, but it could turn into heckling, and we were okay
with our student section.
And we were okay with that, and the players didn't mind it. They liked it. The fans liked it. It was just really hard to monitor it, and that's really
right.
where the problem was. We don't have the staff to be at every corner, and in a tennis match, you can get really close to the players.
Right.
So you know they're saying something to the players, but you can't be everywhere. So
right.
They would say things that they were not allowed to say.
How did the other coaches from other teams react to that? Did they ever complain to you and say, you need
yeah.
to need to put a cork in your fans or what?
No, you know, yeah, they would complain, especially, you know, if we were winning. But the truth is that the part that I felt very comfortable is because I do believe that the tennis could become more fan-friendly and allow them to be a little bit more involved in the match. And at TCU, at our facility, the stands are so far from the court.
Mm-hmm.
So it really, of all the places, TCU had the least advantage with that rule. You go to Texas Tech or Baylor, they're right behind, they're on top of you. So that part I'm glad that it's that way, so I could freely, and they didn't think it was. I was just trying to look for a from home court advantage.
But Baylor kind of did that before, to an extent, didn't it? Weren't their fans a little known for being a little boisterous at times?
Baylor
years ago, I mean, 10 years ago or so.
Are you trying to egg me on? Do you want me?
No. I'm
not. Isn't 62-22 enough? Do I really have to talk about? Baylor fans could. You know, even the Roditi rule, they found a way around it and break it, and that's part of the problem. You know?
Okay.
We have Baylor rules in the NCAA tennis manual. We have Baylor rules. We have Baylor rules.
I think we're about to have more Baylor rules, too.
They were formed just because they found a loophole in certain things, so
right.
We could have to come up with a rule to keep them from doing that.
I understand. So, well, yeah. Listen, you were a student here in 1993 through 96, and you came in here under the tutelage of the great Tut Bartson. Tell us a little bit about Coach Bartson and what he meant to you.
Coach Bartson, I think I speak for a lot of alums, tennis alums. He was what you would think of a mentor and someone that was so well respected by all the players, as a player and as a coach, as a person. He was as consistent as you will ever find in a coach. He was, very, very true for what he believed, and you were never, he would never really get too upset or too happy either, not too much, but you kind of knew what to expect every single day from Coach, and he was a great role model. He would be out there working harder than we were, and he was in his 60s or 70s at the time, and he would be out there in the ball machine, middle of the summer, hitting tennis balls, and. So you really had absolutely no excuse but to work your hardest, because that's what he did every day.
I used to, now one of my favorite restaurants in Fort Worth is a place down on Heelan Street. You may have been there. It's called Yogi's. And I go there a lot.
Yes.
And I used to see Toach Bartson and Bobby Brown, who was the president of the American League and a former New York Yankee and a doctor here in Fort Worth. And I'm thinking,
yes.
All these people in this restaurant don't know you got two legends of their game sitting right there dining amongst them, and it was really impressive to see them, and they've been good friends for years.
And they still are. They talk, they probably speak to each other 2-3 times a week.
Wow.
I'm pretty sure. So, yeah, and that's, Bobby Brown, extremely respected as well, Dr. Brown. So, there was a lot of what went on at TCU in those times. We had some very... we were very lucky to be surrounded by those people.
Well, a lot of the younger fans now, of course, Coach Bartson left back, and I believe in the late 90s, I think he retired.
98.
And a lot of the younger fans don't even know who he is, and which is a shame. But he's 89 years old, I believe, or will be soon, and he attended William & Mary College, where he had a 50-0 singles record, which is pretty impressive in and of itself. He won a national NCAA doubles championship with Fred Kowalski in 1948. He played professionally. He was ranked in the top 10 for 9 straight years. Ranked number 8 in the world in 1959. Won 4 U.S. clay court championships. Won the Canadian national championship. He was captain of the Davis Cup team. He was head pro at Colonial Country Club. And then in 1974, he came to TCU, and he changed the face of TCU tennis forever.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. He was also, he has the best record of any American tennis player on Davis Cup. He was 16-0.
Yeah.
He was. He never lost a Davis Cup match either. So his records are unbelievable. He was just a very humble man, very quiet. He never, if Twitter had been around, he wouldn't have had a Twitter account.
Yeah.
maybe his agents would have absolutely forced him to have one, but that was just the way Coach was. He just did his work on the court, and very few people can say that they never lost a match in the NCAAs. They won as a team, never lost in Davis Cup, and became Davis Cup captain. I mean, he was considered the best clay court player in the world for a long time. He, my favorite story is that he was getting married with Bonzo, with Sarah, and he was they were begging him to play this tournament, but it was during his wedding, basically the next day. And the guy begged him and begged him and begged him, and he finally convinced Sarah that, look, if I play this, then this guy will send us to Paris, and that could be a honeymoon. So he agreed, that Bonzo, Sarah, agreed for him to play. And he played a pretty good player and beat the guy 6-0, 6-0 the morning after his wedding night. And I was thinking, man, that's really competitive. You know? It takes a very good competitor to...
The morning after his wedding night.
Yeah, and he's a very Catholic man. He goes to church every single day.
So do you think after the wedding it was just like, hun, let's just go to the room. I got to get some sleep because I got a big match in the morning.
I don't think so.
No?
Okay.
Maybe that's why he defeated him 6-0, 6-0. It's like, I got to get back to my wife, you know? Right. Let's take care of this, you know, right now. I got to get back to my wife.
That's a good point. But he was kind of known. He was the nicest guy in the world. Again, very, very religious, but just nasty competitor as far as he wouldn't say a word, but he would not. If he could beat you where you didn't win one point, he would do it.
Yeah.
He would do it nicely. He would do it with a lot of class, but you wouldn't win one point.
Well, I think the best description, I asked somebody once that knew him, and I said, can you describe him to me? He's one word, gentleman.
Yes, absolutely. But very competitive.
But a competitive gentleman.
That's a part, you know, you don't really see it. I only noticed it a few times. I was pretty... opposite of him in a way of, I don't think gentleman would be the first word that a lot of people would pick for me, especially if they played against me. And I was playing a match. It was a big match against UCLA, and it was coming down to my match, and it got ugly with the guy that I was playing and myself. And there were a lot of sort of mind games. And tennis is a very personal competition, and it's kind of like a boxing type thing. It's just you and him. And I basically, my only chance of winning that match was to get under his head. And I did. I got under his head. And Coach Bartson, he didn't say a word. He just walked away. He didn't say, look, you're not going to do that, or stop it, or you don't want to, you know, win that way. He wasn't going to be part of it. But he saw that it was working, so he just walked away and allowed it to happen. Yeah, I won that match. But we lost.
So what do you do when you get under his head? Do you jaw back and forth with each other? Because I know in football, you know that goes on out there, and basketball a little bit too.
Of course.
So you're out there, because we can't, when you're in the stands, you can't hear the players talking to each other. So you're out there getting, seeing a few things.
Everything, you know, it sounds so childish, and it is childish. But at this point, I was desperate. He was much better than I was. It was the quarterfinals of the NCAAs, big, tall, lefty, French-Canadian, and I had heard that the only way you could probably beat him is if you get under his skin. So, you know, anything from taking longer than you should take, and then I hit him a couple times during the point, not after the point, but I had a ball where I could hit it anywhere, and I hit it right in the back of his back, and that was it. He just flipped. And I went from not being able to win a point to almost not even losing a point. He just flipped, and he just couldn't handle it. So,
So you beat him into submission.
Yeah, it was. I mean, it was. Yeah. It's something that you're not, you know, too proud of. And,
right.
But at the time, I was like, all right, whatever. It was within the rules. It's just not. You know, it's gamesmanship.
Yeah, I mean, I would say. Thinking about other sports, like Wes was talking about, like football and basketball, that seems kind of, like you said, it just seems kind of minor. Like, you're going to hit the ball anywhere, and you just hit it right back at him, and you hit him with the ball. And
yeah, he had his back turned.
Right. And I think a lot of people, when they're looking at tennis, they're thinking, well, that doesn't really seem like that's that big of a deal.
Right.
And, I mean, I can see how that can kind of unnerve a guy, but at the same time, you know, as you're saying, like your coach is just like turning his back on it, like, you know, it's working, but you got to do what you got to do. I'm not going to be a part of it. It just seems a little odd for somebody looking on the outside in on tennis who doesn't really know a whole lot about tennis tradition. It's like, because it is kind of a gentleman's, kind of like golf, you know, it's kind of that gentleman's game. So that's something that it's kind of frowned upon. You don't play those kind of games in tennis.
Right, even though it goes on all the time. It's very personal. In tennis, it's very personal. You know, Andy Roddick, he said it one time. He had a hard time playing Roger Federer because he was just the nicest guy. You know, Roger was so nice. He's such a gentleman that Andy would sort of thrive. He wanted to make it personal. He wanted his opponent to do something to give him a reason to try even harder. And Roger was just so nice and gentlemanlike that he just couldn't bring that out of Andy. So it's there's a lot going on. We talk about it as coaches in tennis. There's a game within the game. There's a game that only the two players and maybe a coach that's on the court kind of knows what's going on. And the pitching and the batting, I can see that getting a little bit. You know, you start pitching a little closer to them, or
yeah, give them a little chin music,
a little, you know, crowning the plate a little bit. So you see it, but it's tennis is it really is one of the few sports where it's just one on one, and there's no coaching typically, except in college. There's no coaching, so it's just you and your opponent, and you know even as kids you got to make your own calls, and there's a lot of that going on.
Well, I guess that kind of explains now, because Jimmy Connors was known when he was young for being kind of loud on the court, and then John McEnroe following that. But John McEnroe was always yelling at the
lines.
Well,
he was a gentleman. What are you talking about? He was
McEnroe, yeah.
He was well-behaved.
He cannot be serious, yeah.
But the linesman and anybody out there would get his wrath, and I don't know if his opponent ever got it, but I guess that was his way of getting under their skin. It was screaming and distracting him. And
yeah, I think people would say that there's a slight difference between Connors and McEnroe, and McEnroe, that was his way of almost kind of getting himself going, or finding or coping with the nerves, or coping with something that was going against him. He would start taking it on the umpires and create that so that his mind would go away from what was making him uncomfortable about the match. Jimmy was more into the gamesmanship part, and he would be, you know, a lot of times nasty with his opponents, and he would get into it more with his opponents and say things, that weren't very nice. So I would say that's kind of the difference between it. And so then when they played each other, it was ugly.
Will you have any guys like that on the team this year?
Unfortunately.
That you want to admit to.
You know, Cameron Norrie, our number one player, he's doing really well. He's going to be a junior. He's one that he's the highest professional tennis player in college at the moment. He's probably the highest professional player that still is planning, that's decided to stay and continue his degree in the last 20 or 30 years.
Wow.
I'm not sure anybody's been as high as he is right now on the ATP Tour. He got up to 270 in the rank, in the world rankings, which is, you know, it's kind of like AAA level type thing.
Right.
And he's very unassuming, but he is extremely competitive. And if I was playing him, I probably wouldn't want to get under his skin, and because it's only going to make him play better. And I think that's what.
So he plays better under pressure. He plays better when the other guy is trying to get under his skin.
Yeah,
trying to play those head games.
He's got a really, you know, nasty competitive side of him, not in a bad way, but he just hates to lose. And I think most great athletes hate to lose more than they love to win. And
right.
And Cameron is one of them. I would love to see a little bit more of that in our other players. We have a very nice group of guys, which is great. I love coaching them 98% of the time. It's just that 2% of the time when things get nasty on the court, and that's when you gotta, you know, just compete. We're not doing as well as we could, I think, at right. that moment.
Hmm. Now, talking about your team this year, I was looking at the roster, and you've got 10 players on it currently. And 40% of them, you've got people that are from other countries. You've got Colombia, Mexico, New Zealand, and Chile. And then you've got 6 Americans. And you and I talked about this a little bit off the air, but You said to have 60% of the U.S. players is pretty good these days.
That's really good. We actually brag about it. So of the top teams, we were able to finish third last year. Of the top teams, I said Virginia, they won it. They're mostly Americans. They have a lot of Americans. But everybody else, it's mostly foreigner. I would say there are some teams that have, I think Baylor, when they won the national championship, it was 100% of them were foreigners. And you have teams even from one country. Texas Tech at one point had 6 Brazilians playing under top 6.
Wow.
So it's a very international sport. It's so individual, so it's very easy for me, without ever seeing a player, to know if he could be from Estonia, and all I have to do is go on the internet and look at his results, and it gives me a really good idea of what his level is.
Are there some countries now that you look at that tend to turn out the top tennis players at that age level that you kind of prefer to recruit from?
Yeah, the same countries that you would imagine. French players typically have a great fundamentals. You get a lot of the, kind of strong physical type players from a place like Germany. Very good players from Argentina or Spain. They produce a lot of really good players. And then you have the whole Eastern Bloc, Czech Republic, and that's gets a little harder in the Eastern Bloc because of the language barrier. But and then South Africa, Australia, and England are great places. One, they have very good tennis tradition in those countries, and also they speak English. So
yeah,
that helps.
That's a big help. So I would say those are the main ones.
Okay, interesting.
Maybe Mexico one day will be a great hotbed for tennis players.
Well, you came from Mexico, so it's one of their best up here to TCU.
Yeah, we do have one of their best players, but I'm helping out with the Mexican Davis Cup team.
Oh, are you really?
I'm actually the Mexican Davis Cup captain. So one of my, I guess, in my agenda is to sort of educate the coaches down there and the federation that our team at TCU would beat the Mexican Davis Cup team today. So why are these 18-year-old boys not going to college? They're not good enough to make it on the tour. It's proven that a tennis player doesn't peak until 27, 28 years old, so there's no hurry. It only costs you money. So they should go to college and get their degree and come out at 22. So anyway, so that's a big topic right now going on in the tennis world.
Interesting.
But what about scholarships? Because we talked about with Coach Losch, and there's an obvious, I won't necessarily say disadvantage, but there is a bit of an issue, though, with the way scholarships are handled with a sport like football as opposed to baseball. How are scholarships handled in tennis?
It's everything that Schlossnagel said. I agree 100%. We're right on the same boat. We fight the same fights. I would say that 90% of your success as a team is how well you can stretch and maximize your scholarship. We get a 4.5 scholarships.
Okay. Oh,
our women's team gets 8. So you can imagine the difference there. So you need at least 6 players to just make a team.
Right.
So you could be a starting player on the national championship team, and you don't have any scholarship at all.
So you have to recruit players who not only are worthy of playing at this level, but also who can afford to pay part of their education here.
Yeah, they either have to be really good, really really good, so that you can give them a scholarship. So literally one of the best 10 or 20 players in the world, or 15 players in the world, so we can afford to give them 90% or. You know, we hardly ever give anybody 100%. Or you have to be very wealthy, so you don't need scholarship. That doesn't happen very often. Or you need to be extremely smart and get get academic scholarship. But, at TCU, these days, it's gotten so competitive. To get any scholarship, you have to score above well, it used to be 1900, 2000, so now it's about 1350, 1400. Well, if you're a tennis player and you've competed and traveled so much and you still get a 1350, 1400, chances are you're looking at schools like Harvard and Princeton.
Right. Because the amount of time that's spent doing all the competition as opposed to studying.
Yeah,
and
yeah. They can get into a Stanford, and so it's hard to get them to come to TCU. So you're kind of looking for any kind of combination, maybe some academic. You can combine. The good thing about academic money is you can combine academic with athletic. Financial aid-wise, based in need, you can't combine it, really. So, you know, if let's say you don't have a dime and you can qualify for the maximum financial aid package at TCU, it's $30,000. Well, you still have to come up with another $25,000.
Wow.
So if you qualify for $30,000, you don't have another $25,000.
Right.
So it's a battle. It's a war, and you know, the good thing is that our administration understands it. And our athletic director and CDC and my boss, Kim Johnson, they understand why we have to do things like we bring in a guy in January, like we are in this January, we're bringing a guy. So if you bring him in January, that saves you half a year of scholarship. And then you might have a guy like Rybakov did this semester and take a semester off. That saves us 50% right there. So it's like revolving doors, and you're always playing the numbers.
It's kind of like salary cap in football, professional football, where you can play around with the scholarship dollars.
Absolutely, absolutely. And just like baseball, a guy like Cameron Norrie or Alex Rybakov, they're on the tour. I mean, they're currently playing professional tennis. So if they do well, any minute, they might just turn pro. So
they're able to compete professionally.
Yes.
Now, are they able to, if they win a purse or something, do they have to, because the NCAA, are they saying, no, we can't accept
that?
They
can take, if they go play a professional tournament on their own, so they're not representing TCU, and it's weird, you could actually represent TCU in a professional tournament.
Okay.
We can send them with a coach, just like a college tournament. Then they can't take any money. But if they go on their own, like Cameron is the next 2 weeks, it's an outside competition. He is allowed to take the prize money, but at the end of the year, from January 1st to December 31st, he has to break even. So someone like Cameron, who did extremely well this summer, it's hard to turn the money down. I mean, why would you?
Right.
You just need to spend it.
Yeah, I mean, as a college kid, I don't know any college kid is going to turn down money.
Right. So right now, he's got 2 months to make sure he breaks even. So
how does he break even? Explain.
You fly first class and stay at a nicer restaurant and you eat, a nicer hotel and you...
So does it have to be like expenses during
your
trip?
It has to be expenses at a competition.
So you're like buying new luggage every time and...
Ooh, that's a good one. Yeah. We hadn't thought about that one.
Okay.
All right. I think he needs new luggage.
New iPads for on-flight entertainment?
No, it has to be tennis equipment. Shoes, string. I guess you could buy a racket, but that one's... Mm. Stringing, they spend a lot of money in string and rackets. Mm. So it's only sleeping arrangements, travel, food, transportation, and equipment. You can't claim a coach.
So you can't like buy a car to drive himself to a competition.
Well, I guess you would have to.
That doesn't work out.
That's above my pay. You probably have to. Yeah. What's the word? Amortize or what's the word?
Amortize
over so many
3 years. Yeah.
Yeah. Like the life of the life.
Hiring
of the car,
a CPA to help you with your prize winnings.
You know what? You kind of do. Uh-huh. You kind of do. I mean, it really is. And we're right in the middle of that war. So Cameron. Is if I were on the tour right now and I would be traveling with Cameron Norrie because he's got to stay at really nice hotels and
penthouse suite,
maybe Uber LX or whatever you call it, and he's got to spend some money. So those are the guys you want to hang out with, right? Maybe you get some of the benefits. So he's doing great. It's a good problem to have. It's just there is really, and that's part of the whole thing with a country like Mexico. there's no reason not to go to college and get a degree, because you can still manage your academics, you know, your degree. Now the problem comes when you travel on your own and it's outside competition. Your excuses are not, they're not TCU excused. So you got to make sure you don't have professors that are strict with their attendance.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah, these are all the little ins and outs of our world and things that we have to deal with. And I'm sure baseball, very similar to baseball, very, very similar. I when I first came to TCU, within the first 6 months, I knew how well Coach Losh had done, and I love what he's done, the atmosphere that he's created, and how he's gotten into the community, and I thought that's exactly what we want our tennis program to be. It's, we're literally following Coach Losh's philosophy and what he's done with baseball. We would love for tennis to be the same. We just there's a few more things that we need to do, and we're kind of on our way, I guess.
Now, speaking of rackets, I know we're a Nike school, but does Nike provide the they don't provide rackets, but the shoes and uniforms and shirts and everything, but how about rackets? Does every player bring his own racket, or do you have a sponsor for something like that?
No, we buy them for them.
You buy them?
We buy them for them, and it's, we have a rule. If you break it, you buy it.
Okay.
And that was probably because I probably broken more rackets than anybody in the history of TCU. So I knew that if I had to buy it, you don't break it. Eventually, you stop breaking them.
You take a little more, better care of them.
Call it the John McEnroe rule. Is that how that works?
Well, I think he got them for free. So
it's not a big deal when you got them. We have them for free, but
yeah. Well, that's a thing. You know, my coach just finally got tired. Coach Bartson just didn't know what to do with me about. He started charging me $75 per point penalty.
Wow.
And I was on a Pell Grant. So when he took $225 from me after one weekend, I think he felt terrible. I think he felt absolutely terrible. And so he just thought, okay, this guy has no hope, but I can't take it. I didn't have any money. I mean, I literally had a Pell Grant. So he never did it again. But I think if I had to buy my own rackets, I would have done it.
Yeah, well, if it's coming out of your pocket, you tend to appreciate it a little bit more.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. So.
Well, let's look at this year's team. What do you got? You've got,
got
three
team.
Seniors, three juniors, four sophomores.
We only have one senior.
One senior?
Yeah, two of them quit.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah. They didn't like not, they weren't getting enough playing time, I guess. And, they quit. I was disappointed. I understood one of them. The other one, I thought he could have. I thought he left a great opportunity, especially in doubles. I thought he left a great opportunity out there to possibly even win the NCAA. It's a great story. It's a kid that had no business playing Division I tennis, and we got him to a point where he could win the NCAA in doubles, and he thought that was enough. So whatever. So we have one senior, Jerry Lopez from Mexico. He's our one senior. Then everybody else is, we have a lot of juniors and sophomores.
Okay.
We're very thick there. And then we have one freshman coming in January. So the bulk of our team, 90% of our team, are sophomores and juniors. We're number three in the nation we should have the same exact team, except for that one player that played doubles. We may have a kid that he tore his hamstring in the middle of the NCAAs last year. So he may need surgery, and he may not be ready to play this year. But we have a player from Colombia who should be able to replace him. And so we finished third last year. We had a great season. And a little disappointing ending at the NCAAs. Lost in the round 16, so I think this team remembers that, and we're hoping that we can have another great season, maybe even do better at nationals.
Now your season starts off in I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
Season starts off in January, and you lead off with Northwestern. Why don't you run down your schedule a little bit? You got Northwestern, Tulsa, Pacific, Dartmouth, Columbia, Central Florida, Wake Forest, Cal, Stanford, UC Santa Barbara, Pepperdine. Your you finish up a non-conference with A&M, then you get right to the conference in April 2nd with OSU. Sounds like a pretty salty schedule. Some of these are pretty good tennis teams.
No, it's a very, very tough schedule. And yeah, I mean, I've thought about our schedule a lot. We have some thing, you know, some guys have to sit out at the beginning of the year for NCAA reasons. So that match at Northwestern, they are a top 10 team, top 15 team, returning team. They get everybody plus one more guy. They're a legitimate top 10 team at Northwestern. That's our very first match, so that's we're gonna have our hands full there, and then we go from there to Tulsa, and you know, I don't even know if Cameron Norrie is gonna be able to play for us that weekend. I mean, that's
wow,
because he might be playing in Hawaii in some professional tournament. So, and that's kind of part of the negotiations with him. It's like we'd rather have him for one match than not have him at all. So that's tough. That's gonna be a very tough weekend right away. Then we have the kickoff that we should be able to get through. That's how you qualify for indoor nationals. And then we go indoors. We're not, because of the weather and our facility and all that, we tend to play a lot of indoors in January and February. And mm-hmm. that's why we play on the road a lot during those months, because I don't like playing at our indoor courts. We only have five of them, and they're too fast. So we go on the road a lot, and you see the Dartmouth, Columbia. That's Columbia was top 25, top 20 or 15 2 years ago, and Dartmouth is projected to be a top 25 team. So that's a very tough. Doesn't sound like it, but it's very tough. And who knows what the weather conditions are there in January? So I thought it would be a great experience for our players to go somewhere where they may never go again.
Yeah.
And play some of the Ivy Leagues. They come and play us every year, so I thought it'd be fair to go there. And then you have the Berkeley-Stanford weekend. That's going to be rough. Wake Forest is probably one of the teams favored to win it all. So that's a huge home match, first weekend of March. So our good, you know, the good home matches that we have are going to be Wake Forest. They could be number one in the nation. Some people would say that they might be the team to beat this year. We get them at home. We get A&M, who's typically a top 10, top 15 team at home. We get some of the Big 12 matches here at home. And in South Florida, who is a top 15 team at home. So it should be a fun home schedule for our crowd.
Interesting. How do you look? How's the conference looking this year?
For the last 2 years, the Big 12 in tennis has been the strongest conference in the nation. This year, I feel like Baylor and Oklahoma, who are typically number one, two, three, four in the nation, mm-hmm. I feel like they're not quite as good as they've been in the past. But UT is a top five team probably. Coach Center's done a great job this year, brought two of the best recruits in the nation. So yeah, very tough. I just say it's the toughest conference there is in tennis. We only have six men's teams, and everybody you play. At one point, every team in our conference, all six, were top 15 in the nation last year. So very strong. It's you could be top 20 in the nation and go 0-5 easily.
Wow. Now you touched on something about the indoor courts. You said they're too fast. So I'm kind of getting an education here. I was talking to our former beach volleyball coach, and he was explaining to me about the differences in beach volleyball sand, which
the science of sand.
They made it a concerted effort to find the right sand to suit the skills of their players, which to me is sand to sand. They go down to Home Depot, you buy a 50 pound bag of it.
Play sand, yeah.
But then, and Richard Simsema was telling me about the science of water. Some pools are faster than others, so now we've got fast courts. What makes a fast court, and what do you prefer to play on that suits your team the best?
Well, you know, CDC gets so tired of me talking about this. He thinks I'm just making excuses, and you know, and I laugh because.
Oh, we talked to him a couple weeks ago. He loves it when you guys knock on his door and have requests.
Oh, then he loves me.
Yeah.
Then he loves me. And it's okay. He compares me a lot to Schlossnagel and Coach P, as in a pin in his butt. So I like that. That's a good.
You put high me praise.
In, hey, you put me in company with those coaches, even if it's kind of a dig, I'll take it.
Well, you know,
I'll
he told it. Us he was there to be the wind beneath your wings. So Take that in his office with you.
Yeah, I'll let him know. I'll let him know that. So the tennis courts. Yeah, you have all sorts of even surfaces. You know, you have the clay court and the grass courts, and some are faster than other. Even hard courts, you can have a fast hard court, or you can have a slow hard court. What makes a slow or fast is the amount of sand that you put in the paint for the court. Oh. So our outdoor courts, if you go down there and feel it, they're very greedy, which kills our shoes and our balls. So that's my excuse for going over the budget every year. It's like, oh, we have a lot of sand on our courts. We go through a lot of shoes. They're very greedy.
It's like playing on
rough sandpaper.
It's
like sandpaper, yeah.
Wow. So it's more friction on the ball and the shoes.
Yeah,
and
so the ball hits and it comes up and it picks up spin. The spin really grabs. It's a very high bouncing court in it. So it's a very slow court. So typically, like you would think in clay, and you think of Nadal and all those guys are really good on clay, they're mostly baseline players that like long rallies. The serving, it's not necessarily a huge part of it. It still is, but not like when you go indoor fast court. You could have a guy that all he knows what to do is serve, and he doesn't have to play. He just has to hit a serve, and the surface is so fast, there's no sand, so the ball hits and skids through the court. It would be like playing on one of these tables. The ball would hit and just skid. You can't react. You don't have enough time. So that would be the extreme. Our indoor courts, the way they're built, we have this air conditioning vent in the back. We can't allow them to be slow because then the air conditioning vent would come into play more. So we have to keep them fast and slick, which is the opposite of our outdoor courts. So that's where, and we recruit players that are, that style of play are more conducive to slower, longer points, fitness is important, patient, kind of good head. They know how to set up the point, and it might take them 8 or 9 shots to win a point. Versus recruiting, if I was at Notre Dame and I'm playing indoors all year, I would recruit big guys with big serves that can come forward and take the ball out of the air and put a lot of pressure, Pete Sampras was a big player. Boris Becker, Stefan Edberg, they're guys that would do really well on grass because they would come forward. So anyway, that's interesting.
Are there any grass courts in the NCAA, or is that?
No, we did play one tournament on grass this year at the Hall of Fame in Newport, and that was sort of just more for the tradition of it.
Right.
But yeah, very different. Ball doesn't bounce. Ball skids. You have to come forward. You have to come to the net and. Yeah, so it was very different. 3 of our guys didn't win a match, but it was fun.
How about clay courts?
Very slow. Baseline players like Nadal, who are very physical, who can hit 15, 20, 25 shots in one point. And they can run all day, and they can defend, and they usually play further back on the court and make a lot of balls. Which is, you know, we have guys on the team, like you said, Chile, New Zealand, California, Florida, Las Vegas, Mexico. There's not a lot of indoor courts in any of those places. Mm-hmm. And last year when we lost to Berkeley, they have 5 Swedish guys. So,
well, I remember years ago.
Indoor courts in Sweden.
Yeah, just a few.
Yeah.
Martina Navratilova moved to Fort Worth and lived here simply because there were some clay courts there that she could practice on. Apparently there were none in Dallas that she could work out on.
So. Yeah, now we actually lost those two that are on clay here. We don't have them anymore. Now you have to go to Dallas.
And they were at a church out off of Hewlett Street.
Yeah, I remember practicing on them for the Clay Court Nationals, yes. Clay is great. Clay is a great developmental court for younger kids. And, that's something that we can do better here in Fort Worth is create a more of a tennis-friendly environment for kids.
Is the indoor court one of your kind of wish lists for Del Conte? Just kind of like walk in and go, we kind of need to do something about this facility?
Yeah, I think I've said it a couple times.
Yeah. A little more in passing.
He's sick of it. But, you know, the thing is, there's so much going on at TCU lately and all the facilities. Once we moved into the Big 12, a lot of the facilities needed to upgrade. and right. and look what's happened to football's facility and basketball and volleyball and that track and baseball. Baseball's right. done a great job. And tennis, in reality, is that our facility is considered one of the best in the nation. So I understand there's no urgency.
And it's 40 years old, isn't it? It was built back in the mid-70s.
It's still, I would say, it's the most beautiful tennis facility. It may not be the best or whatever, the newest, but it is the most beautiful. It's a beautiful, beautiful place to just practice every day. We're very lucky.
Well, Coach, I remember when I was in college, because I graduated in 73, and then they built that center there.
Exactly.
And that, when they built that, that was the premier athletic facility at TCU. The stadium, of course, had been old for years. A baseball facility, if you remember, was over there off of near Daniel Meyer.
Yeah, the observatory.
Yeah, and tennis, when I was in college, was played right about where the Rickles Center
Rickle,
was.
Yeah.
Yeah, so.
Yeah. No, it still is. It's a beautiful. So CDC is like, get out of my room. You have one of the best facilities. And he's right. We do. Just when it comes to the indoor courts, we don't. And it's hard because I literally feel every time we play in our indoor courts that we are at a disadvantage.
Mm-hmm.
And we have these stupid rules about wind. If the wind gets above a certain miles per hour, we have to go indoors, which is ridiculous. That's my next Roditi rule that we have to change. it's ridiculous.
The weather rule.
Tennis is an outdoor sport. I understand if it's wet, you can't play, but wind, every professional tournament is played in the summers and in the spring, outdoors, wherever it is in the world, and it's windy.
Right.
You go to Miami for the, Ericsson, it's windy. You go to Palm Springs for the Indian Wells, huge tournament, it's windy. U.S. Open, center court, before the roof, super windy. So, anyway.
Does the wind have that much effect, though? Because, most of the tennis courts I've seen are fairly sunken, and you got the stands around it. So, I'm thinking you almost kind of have like a natural windbreaker, though, in a lot of stadiums.
You have the wind screens. For us, we're sunken with a lot of trees around.
Right.
So, it gets tricky. The wind kind of comes down, and then it
swirls around.
A little bit, which is it's kind of fun to see some home visiting teams kind of deal with it. But it's definitely a part of the game. You got to know how to play in the wind. It would be like being a professional beach volleyball player and not knowing what to do with the wind. It's going to be windy. You're playing by the beach. I'm sure it's windy a lot. So there's, we have I spend a lot of time talking to our guys about how do you play when you're with the wind? How do you play when you're against the wind? How do you play when you have a side wind? It's kind of fun. It's part of the strategy and
things you never think about. You got to play the court. You got to play the opponent. You got to play the weather.
Right.
You got to play yourself, which is at the end of the day, that's tends to be our biggest opponents ourselves.
Right.
So, it's fun. That's there's a lot going on out there than just running over and hitting the ball. But I'm sure every sport is the same.
Sure. Now, do you go to some of the other sporting? I know I saw at the football game a few weeks ago. You're right next door to the baseball facility. You go to the very many baseball games, and
I go when I can to baseball just because we have the same season, so it gets a little tougher. Obviously, postseason we're done by then, and I'm glued to the TV and just so proud of our baseball program. Football, I go to every football game. I have a 2-year-old and a 6-month-old. So it's a little tougher right now to get out in the middle of the week to go catch a volleyball game or a soccer game. It's just tougher. It's just hard, loading up the two kids. But I will say my 2.5-year-old, he already knows the our alma mater song. And he knows when to get his horn, his frogs up and loves every sporting event. So that helps, but it's tough. But I do follow it, and I'm, how exciting is it, our soccer team?
Oh, absolutely.
Oh, team getting amazing
host NCAAs first time. I think it's awesome. I'm really happy for Coach Bell and his staff. Done a great job, and for those girls, they've been waiting for so long.
They've had a terrific season.
No, it's great. Yeah. Great. I think they started undefeated for the first 10 games or so, eight or 10 games.
Yeah, it was like around 9 or so. That fantastic season. Beating teams that nobody was giving us any chance to beat.
Right.
And those girls have played their hearts out this season.
They did, and they lost, is it overtime or in a shootout against West Virginia? But it's
3-2.
3-2, yeah.
Yeah, no, it's exciting. Unfortunately, I'm out of town this weekend. Otherwise, I'd be there. It's exciting. It's great for Fort Worth. It's great for we have some very, great people in town that have supported soccer for so long, and they get to experience that. I think it's great.
Well, it's really interesting because when I was in college, you'd have a few fans at the baseball game. There really were no watching facilities at the old tennis before they built the one they have now. You'd get mothers and girlfriends and brothers, things like that, boyfriends at the women's basketball games. You get a few people at the men's basketball. Football probably averages 20,000 people, but that's not the case anymore. We've got an electric facility in volleyball and tennis, and baseball is well attended. I think baseball is one of the top attended baseball teams in the country.
It's the highest private school.
Yeah, highest private school.
Yeah.
And so the fans have certainly turned out, which has got to be good for you. I'm sure you love it, and the players have got to get a charge from it as well.
That was actually our strategy to begin with. When I came in here in 2010, my one pet peeve of when I was in college, we were ranked 3, 4, 5 in the country every year, and like you said, you have your parent and Terry and Dr. Petrie.
Girlfriends,
some guys had girlfriends and that was it. And I'm like, God, we're top 5 in the country. We can't, can't we get some people? So that was a personal thing. I said, okay, I've been complaining about this. We're gonna do something about it. Talk to Schlossnagel, talk to some of the coaches at TCU. Volleyball's always done a great job. Soccer's always done a great job of getting crowds. And that was our strategy. We got the crowds before we had the top teams. And playing in front of a crowd, there's not a kid that doesn't love that. And then we got some sorority girls to come out and support us. What guy doesn't love that?
Yeah,
So then we got, the Norris and Nunez and Rybakovs and attendance and playing in front of your Horned Frog crowd and your community is literally the number one recruiting tool for us. So for you fans out there and in community right here in Fort Worth, it literally is the backbone of our team. It's for them to feel relevant for that 2-3 hours and play in front of people. They love it. They love it.
Fantastic.
It's been great. And we're lucky. We're lucky with TCU. That where it's located. We're right in the middle of a beautiful neighborhood, very safe area, lots of parking, even though people say there's not enough parking, but I'm sure you go to a school like, University of Texas or some downtown, there's definitely no parking.
No.
So it's very family-friendly location, and it's great. It's lucky. We're lucky that we can do that.
Fantastic. Well, Coach, thank you so much. So we're going to switch to just gear, and we got to talk about Baylor. Just, you mind if we?
Oh my God, 62-22. Please talk about it.
I love this guy.
I will.
I went. I think Sean and I both went there with the same expectation Saturday that we thought we could win. They're certainly not. They're not a team there's nobody left on our schedule we can't beat, but we didn't think...
I'll be honest with you. There's nobody on the schedule this entire season that this team couldn't have beaten if they could put 4 quarters of football together, which has been my drumbeat for the last 4 weeks or so.
Well, they did it on Saturday.
And they did it on Saturday. Finally. Four straight good quarters of football, and they end up blowing the doors off of Baylor in their own home.
Coach, were you able to go down to the game? I'm sure you watched it, though.
I watched every bit of it. I couldn't go again, the kids. But
yeah, sure.
I watched every down. It was just so much fun to watch. I was on one TV. My wife was on the other TV. She was a TCU golfer and a TCU and coach. She was screaming from one room. I was screaming from the other room. A little 2-year-old running around. Touchdown, touchdown. It was fun. It was a lot of fun.
Getting his frog up.
So what did you think on that second place of the game when Baylor got that 81-yard touchdown? You think, oh, boy, here we go. Long day.
Well, I'm sure I was thinking the same thing a lot of people were thinking, like, okay, how did we not catch the first one? Should have been an interception on the first play.
Yeah.
Or it could have been. Not should have been. Could have been. And then they go right back on the same play, and I'm like, oh, no, please. We're going to see this all day. They know something about the matchup of that wide receiver with a...
Well, let's be honest. Tejada had position on that play, and he gets pushed. I mean, it was a push-off.
It was
big time.
It definitely could have been called offensive interference.
Yeah, in fact,
100%.
Wes and I were up in the press box, and sitting next to us was the Baylor quarterback during my time at TCU back in the 90s.
Right.
And he was covering the team for one of the Baylor sites. I can't remember which one it was, like a Rivals or one
something
of those.
Something like that.
But on that play, the minute he got pushed off, that guy was like, oh, man, why did he do that? And then he was completely and totally shocked that they didn't throw a flag on that play.
It was so obvious. So obvious.
It was obvious.
Straight arm, I know.
Yeah.
But it didn't matter, right? I
mean, we came right back
and right back scored immediately right after that.
Yeah. And again and again and, yeah,
and
again.
And then it just didn't stop.
But Tejada had a great, you know, he did a great job from there on. And I don't know, I think Coach P kind of talked to him after that. Right when
he came over and there was a little bit of a moment there where he kind of, you know, let him know, don't worry about it, you'll get him next time, it's okay. And Tejada, to be honest with you, I mean, at the beginning of the season, Tejada's kind of caught a lot of flack. I mean, he's coming off of an injury, and a lot of us were wondering, did he lose a step? Is there something going on? Does he not trust the knee? What's going on? And I'll tell you what, ever since that West Virginia game, this secondary has been fantastic. And Tejada has been great. I mean, he's getting back into that form that we saw at the Peach Bowl back at the end of 2014, where he was just absolutely dominant against Ole Miss. And if you go back, I know we lost the West Virginia game, I know we lost the Texas Tech game, but if you go back and you take a look at those two games, strictly just as that unit, the secondary unit, and you see what Tejada was doing, you see what Orr was doing at safety, you see what Lewis is doing now that he's back in the mix, that unit is starting to become almost like a lockdown unit.
Yeah.
I mean, you keep Tech to way below their season averages. You keep West Virginia to way below their season averages. And now they've kept Baylor
way below
their season averages. We now have the – and how crazy is this? We now have the number one defense in the Big 12, statistically.
That is hard to believe.
From where they were at the beginning of the season to where they are now, they're the number one defense in the Big 12.
And – I mean, it's surprising from what was going on earlier in the season, but not surprising when, you know, Coach P and we all know what a great defensive coach he is, and what, look at the difference from first game to the last game, to this last game. It's fun. I mean, that, you know, that's it's fun to watch from a coach, just to see the improvement. From one to the next. So
well, and we get that. Every year, you can always count on it. Coach P's defense will get better throughout the year. They're not like your typical football team where they kind of peak after the first three games.
No.
And that's kind of where you're at. Every single week, they get better. And what's scary, if I'm a coach in the Big 12, what's scary is now is that these guys have gotten as good as they have gotten to this point, and being able to keep West Virginia, Texas Tech, and Baylor, probably the three best offenses in the Big 12, under their season averages, and knowing that pretty much every single guy on that side of the ball is back again next year. If they figured it out halfway through the season at this point, I mean, we're looking at another dominant TCU defense moving forward. I don't want to christen anything yet, but
that's exciting.
It is an exciting thing.
And should be fun, yeah. And the offense is coming along. I think Kenny Hill has really gotten – I read the article in the paper about Cumbie just going up and say, hey, just calm down. We need you to be the player you can be. Don't worry about the interceptions. And he looked great.
He really did.
He managed the offense. Is what he's supposed to do.
Well, it was kind of a mix. It was kind of like a throwback to the Andy Dalton days. You know, here's a guy who took care of the ball, made good decisions, went through his progressions. When nothing was there, he either threw the ball away, which was very, very nice to see, or he made a play with his feet. And he trusted that open field a bit more than what I've seen in the past. In the past, he seemed a little reluctant to take off. And this time around, he did take off. He had a couple of really big plays on where nobody was open. And he just took off with it. And Baylor gave him the middle of the field. And they regretted it after the fact. But he was spot on. And that was probably the best game Kenny Hill has played all season long.
Yep, no doubt about it.
Yeah.
Well, I think Hicks just scored another touchdown.
Yeah. Yeah, Hicks is still scoring touchdowns after that. Five touchdowns on the day. But the second most number of touchdowns in TCU history, or tied for the second most. I think, what was it, six or seven for the most?
Six for LaDainian. right?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
And I assume that was a sun ball against.
I think he tied LaDainian. I don't think LT actually has the record. I think LT had 5 touchdowns. That may have been the San Diego State game.
Well, LT has the most yards, 405
yards. Oh, yeah, yeah, definitely.
I think it was Tony Jeffrey back in the 80s.
I think he had 7.
Right.
I think that was right. Oh, okay. But I mean, Hicks was a beast. And at the beginning, I remember at halftime, we were doing our halftime show, and I told Wes, I said, something just looks a little bit off. He isn't cutting the way he is. He isn't reading what he is. And what it was is that he was being more patient. He was taking a step back, and he was kind of reading where the lines were. He was waiting for his blockers. He didn't quite hit that hole as quick and as aggressive as I normally saw him. I was worried because coming off of what looked like an injury the previous week, maybe there was something there. But there was nothing to worry about with Kyle Hicks. He was absolutely fantastic.
No, he was great.
Yeah.
He was good.
How exciting is Turpin to watch every time he touches the ball? I'm just waiting for a highlight.
He's magical. He's absolutely magical. I mean, talk about a special player in Turpin. And Wes, we've discussed him a lot. But here's a guy who is arguably the leader on that offensive side of the football.
No question.
I think sophomore. He's the leader.
Yeah.
And every single time he is in, something happens.
Yeah.
I mean, the defense has to account for him every single time. I mean, every time they lined up and we were looking across the line and we were trying to figure out where the play was going, and he was in there, either the ball was going to go to Turpin or he was being used as a decoy to set up a running play or set up a play action or something else on there. He was involved in pretty much every single time he was in on a play, he was involved in it some way, in a major way. And anytime he touches the ball,
yep.
My gosh.
Do you think he'll continue to get more and more touches as the season goes on?
Well, yeah, I'm sure
as that injury
heals up more
right.
and more. I think
right.
a couple of weeks ago, Coach Patterson said he was at about 85%. Well, 85% Turpin's better than 100% of a lot of other people.
Oh, yeah.
And so he looked like he was about 95% on Saturday. So he was
protecting himself a bit. I mean, there were a couple times he ran out of bounds. Instead
you ought to give him a tennis racket and see what he can do.
Yeah, you're looking for guys to play on fast courts. How about Turpin?
Yeah, well, you know, I don't want to take his confidence away. You know? We've had players come out and try. Tennis is hard.
Yeah.
It really is. There's so much to it. It's one of our problems. It really is hard. But no, we welcome any athlete out there to come and play. You know who was a great tennis player was Jensen Whitty.
Jensen Whitty yeah. was a great
tennis,
tennis player.
He was actually a...
Wow, didn't know that.
I was shocked when, because I was a coach, and he was one of the best 12 and 13-year-olds in the nation in tennis. And I was shocked that he was better in baseball. I couldn't believe it. I'm like, well, how much better than number 5 in the nation can you be?
Yeah.
And he still is. He still is a great yeah. tennis player. Yeah. So he's
well,
exceptional. All the other ones, it's tough. I would love to have some of the football guys out there.
Next time we have him on, we're gonna talk
Let
to him
know.
About that.
Yeah,
I want
to do that.
I know he was a big tennis guy.
Well, guys, we're out of time.
I don't, wow. Really?
Yeah, 9:00.
We just started getting into it. We haven't even talked about Coach Art Briles Appreciation Day.
Well, I mean, nothing better than beating Coach Art Briles and Coach Art Briles Appreciation Day. So.
I tell you, how silly was that? And let's just take, I don't know about Wes, but let's just take a couple of quick moments here to discuss how tone deaf do you have to be a Baylor alumni with everything hanging over their head right now to pull that stunt?
Pretty tone deaf. And those assistants,
they just keep stepping in it. They can't get out of their own way.
No, I don't really care.
You know, not that I'm giving you any advice. Don't get out of your own way. By all means, keep stepping in it, because if anything else, it's certainly entertainment for the rest of us if it wasn't so sad of the situation down there. But still, I when we got there and we saw them selling T-shirts about that, I couldn't believe it.
No.
Could not believe it. But you're right. There's nothing better than beating Baylor on Coach Art Briles Appreciation Day.
And I say, let's leave it at that.
Did you say it was 62-22? Have we talked about that?
Yes. Oh, did we? No, we didn't mention it. How? 62-22.
I think it was 62-22.
40 points.
And you know,
on Coach
if my math is right, and my 6-year-old tells me that this is correct, 62 is greater than 61.
That's right.
Just want to throw that out there.
you know, as a coach and, you know, I'm an alumni, but I'm also a staff and a coach. So, you know, when it comes to the whole Arbiles, and there's just not a lot I can say. But there was a lot I wanted to tweet and put on Facebook, but I like my job, so I just better not.
You just, like, just set it to private mode and then vent.
Oh, well, no. We can let you have our account, and you can go in there and tweet it.
No, they say once you put it in the web, it's there forever, right?
That's so true. That's true.
Lesson the hard way.
Well, so we'll let you be the gentleman tennis coach, and we'll leave on that.
Remember, Coach Barton would never
Barca,
do that.
Exactly.
Yes, right.
Oh man.
Follow his example. What would he have said about Baylor? He would have stood up, turned around, and walked away, right?
Yeah, that train is long gone. There's not a lot of similarities with Coach and I, but we did go vote together, though. That was pretty cool.
That's good.
That was good to go with Coach Barton and vote. And I told him, Coach, we can either both vote and break even, or we can neither of us vote and it'll be the same, too.
Yeah.
He didn't like that. He's like, no way, you're voting for her. He's like, Coach, I can't vote for the other person. Anyways.
Well.
All right.
I think that you're right. I think we're done for the week. We are out of the way. We do have a bye this week. So
we have a bye next this week. And
our prediction is we win the bye.
Yeah.
And I don't think there's anything more we need to say than that. And
okay.
And so we're looking forward to next week's game against Oklahoma State.
Oklahoma State right here at Amon Carter Stadium.
Yeah, everyone needs to come out early. And we don't know yet. The time of the game is actually going to be dependent upon this weekend's games.
Okay.
Yeah, that was the news that came out earlier this week. So we're all still waiting. Hopefully it's going to be a night game. That'd be nice. Yeah. So there we go.
So exciting. I can't wait.
Yeah,
I want to see more TCU football. That was a lot of fun to watch.
Yeah, hopefully we get another game, four full quarters of football.
That's right.
And we run Oklahoma State right out of the state.
And then in January, let's come out and turn out in mass to see the TCU tennis team go on to the season.
Yeah.
Yes, come out to our home opener on January 24th, 25th, that weekend. We'll be playing our first home match. So
be loud.
Come out. Very loud.
Very loud.
Obnoxious.
But don't heckle. Is that
it's
it?
Okay.
It's okay to heckle?
Yeah,
it's okay.
Okay.
It's okay. It's okay. Coach said it, so it's okay. You can heckle.
You do it until they tell you not to. Then.
Okay.
All right. All right. And next week, join us again for another Killer Frogs Hour. We're going to have hopefully a baseball guest this time.
Let's hope so.
One you don't want to miss now that the professional season is over, so there's a little hint. So we will we'll welcome him in, hopefully, and we'll announce that. We'll announce that soon.
All right.
All right.
Let's go, Frogs.
Go, Frogs.